feel free to curse.
Yeah.
You're a few days away from opening. Do you get nervous or?
Not so much, you know. Not because I, you know, I'm so proud of my film that I've. No, it's not that. Is we work for 7 years, and I'm just so happy that it's finished. I love the film. I'm proud of it. I'm proud of the 2,000 people who works on it. So then after you wait, you know, to who's gonna like it, who's gonna adore it, who's gonna hate it, and it. You know, it's always like this. There is always someone to say, oh my God, it's genius. And the other one say, oh, it's a piece of shit. So I'm used to that. So I'm just waiting. But I have the real satisfaction that I'm proud of the film. I know that, you know, the film in 10 years or 15 years, I will watch it with pleasure. And so I'm kind of happy.
Do you pay attention to all the, you know, love it, hate it stuff of it, or?
No, not at the moment of the opening, to be honest, because it's such a, it looks like, you know, 15 lions starving, and then I'm just a piece of meat in the middle of it. So, no, I take few months, you know, you let the thing, you know, you let the wave going, the numbers, is it good? Oh, it's a hit, oh, it's a flop. It's you put that on the side for a few months, and then you will know what is your film. You will know in a few months. It's very funny because the other day we went to Cinespia, you know, the festival on open air, and they show The Fifth Element 20 years later. And there's like 6,000 people screaming every time someone comes on the screen. And and it was so alive. And even the film was like, it was still there. I mean, special effects are not so good.
It's very different. I watched it the other night, actually. It was on cable
Oh, on cable.
And so I watched it again, and it was kind of, I mean, I love that movie.
So it's still there, you know?
Yeah.
And when the film opened in U.S. theatrically, like 20 years ago, same, you know, critics were pretty bad, and the people doesn't know what to think about the film. And it took a little while, and 20 years later, the film is a kind of like cult everywhere around the world, and I'd rather that, in fact, you know, that's for me the real life of a film. It's like if 10, 15, 20 years later, people still, you know, smiling and say, oh, you should see it, that's a real victory, in fact.
Well, that kind of happened on Big Blue, too. Certainly in America, it barely got seen, and then after some of your other movies came out, then people started seeing it here, and it became kind of a cult thing.
Yeah, it happened the same thing in the Big Blue. Same thing with Leon. Leon the Professional didn't start very well, and the critics were not so good, and it's also a hidden. I hope Valerian, for once, will be a success right away, and I don't have to wait 20 years.
So people are shocked and horrified by the idea that that the movie is not financially not this giant risk. This has been a big conversation about the expense of the movie. Every story seems to lead with the most expensive movie ever made in Europe and that kind of thing. But you've explained that pre-sales and whatever has got you covered for most of the movie already.
Yeah, I'm surprised. I think it comes from one newspaper, French newspaper, who's make this article. And basically, the guy that just don't know what he's talking about. He never called us, so he just do his paper, you know, on the side, and it was just ridiculous because he doesn't know how we produce the thing. I mean, if you don't find 90% of the money before you start, the bank will never allow you to do it.
Right.
So if we are allowed to do it, it's because the financing was good and okay. So it's very simple. So.
And STX was relatively late in this whole process.
Yeah, STX arrived 6 months later, 6 months ago. And the what's interesting is the real risk is the risk of a reputation, in fact. Because there's many people around the world, many countries who believe me and give me some advance for the film. Yeah, sure, if the film doesn't work in their own country, if I come back in 6 months and say, oh, I have another idea, they will probably, you know, say, look, we're fine for now. But, so that's the risk. But the risk by itself financially is relatively small, in fact.
So you've built Europa since you became, you started kind of as a director, a straight director, and then you've become this kind of massive international producer. Is that a satisfying occupation for you? Is that a big, you know, was that a big chunk of your life that you were, is it a different hat or a different feeling or?
No, I'm not the CEO of the company, so it's not my everyday business. Mm-hmm. My real concern, my real love is writing, editing, shooting, directing. I love the relationship with the actors. And so my life is pretty creative. And if I was like a super good businessman, I would be richer. And no, it's never been my goal. What happened, in fact, is at the beginning, no one wants to produce me. Mm. So I create my own company just because no one wants to do it. I mean, I wish I could find, at the time, a producer on a big studio who say, look, don't think about, you know, go work on your film, let us do it. Mm-hmm. I would love that, but that's not the thing, that's not how it happens. So no one wants to produce my first film, so I find some money to produce it, and mm-hmm. then I learn. But it's not my passion. My passion is really to make the films and to write them.
Have you done as many films as a director as you'd want to do? It seems like there have been some gaps in your...
No, I think the first, what's interesting is I remember clearly at 16, 17, 18, say, please God, let me do one, I swear, just one. And then when I finished the first one, I said, God, please, I'm sorry, I know I said just one, but can I have just one more, just two? And I remember that very clearly. I remember, like, after three or four, I start to get amazed and say, oh my God, I thought I will do one, and I'm already doing four. And I was, like, astonished. And now it's 17 films, and I'm still amazed. I'm amazed that I'm still there. Mm. I really always thought that... the people eat you for a couple of years and then they throw you. Mm-hmm. And so I was waiting for that to be thrown away after two films or three. Mm. And I don't know, it's a kind of miracle. I'm still there, and every time I say, you want one more? And they say, yeah, sure, good. So I'm still there, I'm happy.
So does this feel like a not a step backwards, but a step more to your youth and to your passion as a child? Is it, I mean, this film, your films have been, you know, you've gone to some very serious places at times, you've gone to some wild places, but this feels like it's kind of steeped in your childhood and comic books and...
No, I think I'm always working by reaction. So after Fifth Element, I went to Joan of Arc. Mm-hmm. Like...
So you wanted to go somewhere very different?
Yeah, like 15th century. Mm-hmm. I love that. I love to, you know, like, for example, I worked for 7 years and there's 2,700 special effect in Valerian. My next film, there's no special effect for sure. I don't mm-hmm. know. I don't know exactly what will be the film, mm-hmm. but I want a tiny thing with actors, dialogues, situation, and no special effect. Mm-hmm. And if I do that, then I will be happy. If we can make a Valerian 2, I will be happy to do it. Mm-hmm. But I can't go straight from one to the other. It's just like you have the feeling to eat the same food over and over again, and you just want to change. Mm. You know, in the summer, you wish for the snow. And on the winter, you say, oh my God, I want the sun. So I'm the same with the films.
So you, seeing Fifth Element again, a lot of the effects are in camera. There's kind of very... effects from that moment. I mean, it was kind of cutting edge back then, but it's obviously changed a lot. Is making a film that's this in your head and that is all is so digital and so much unreal visual material that you have to create beyond just what happens on the stage a very, very different experience, or is it all the same to you ultimately?
The big change is it's 20 years later and I have 20 years more of experience. So I feel much more comfortable on Valerian than I was on the Fifth Element. On the Fifth Element, it was a nightmare. The special effect was very slow and not controllable. And here, the technology and the knowledge that Weta or ILM they have is just amazing. The director has really the freedom to shoot the way he wants, even on shoulder, mm-hmm. with the actors, and you turn to them and they say, like, don't worry, it's okay. Yeah. And then you let them do it, and then when you see the results, you're just like, you know, your jaw is just like falling down because you can't believe that they can do that.
Do you like having that much control of every image? I mean, ultimately, you can tweak everything, almost.
Yeah, it's not so much it's not a question of control, like, this is me, I want that. It's more like, I realize, in fact, that these people, they love to have guidance. They are in trouble when the director can't choose. And they told me that there's a lot of guys in town where here they don't know, they change. And I'm not like this. I know what I want, so I explain it. And then they deliver what I ask. But they, in a way, they prefer that. They prefer someone. So it's not a question of authority. It's more a question of, do you know what you want exactly? Mm-hmm. You know, so if the shot goes too slow, I can say it. I say, it's a little, the pace is maybe a little more aggressive in the movement, or I give indication we are very clear for them to work.
And when the visuals come back in, are you a big tweaker, or is it kind of like a collaborative work? I'm thinking of a lot of the visuals in this movie that aren't, I think, are completely digital, that don't even have, you know, suits or anything else. Are you obsessive about it, or are you kind of liking the fact that somebody else has an idea?
Let's take an example. Okay. There's a scene at the beginning called Big Market. Mm-hmm. Big Market is two worlds on the same place. So one is a desert with no one. The other one is a mall with 1 million shops on 500 levels. If you put a helmet, you can see through, and you can see both worlds. All right? Mm-hmm. The hero block his arm in one world and the rest of his body in the other one. That starts to get complicated. So in the mall, you have thousands and thousands of aliens. For five years, we work with the artist, and we built a library of aliens, and there is like 500. And every time they come with a proposal, that's where I'm open. Mm-hmm. I say, oh yeah, I love this one. Yeah, this one is good. But it's a little, make it more sweet, more cute. Make it like smaller and chubby a little bit. Mm-hmm. And the color, I'll kind of like, make it more funny. And the guy come back with the thing. I say, oh, okay, now I like it. In the box. Mm-hmm. So what we did is we took the 500 aliens and we give it to ILM. And now ILM, I agree with all the aliens. So and then I let them put where they want and play with them. So that's where they have their creativity, and they can have an action in it, because I'm controlling who is in town. I know exactly who is in town, right. And I know the set. Mm-hmm. I know exactly because I agree on the shop, on the thing, the level, the canyon, everything. And then I let them play, in fact.
So what's it like when you first see Big Shop, for instance?
So you see it by lays.
Right.
So the first few lays, you're depressed. You say, oh my God, it will never work. And there is a moment, I think it's the third or fourth step, where suddenly you're like, whoa, okay, that's working. And then after that, you have five more. And usually, except few shots, but usually after three, I'm amazed. I'm like, wow. And then when I see the fourth, I say, oh my God, it's even better. And I don't know how they can make it better. And then the fifth arrived, and I'm like, oh my God, it's better. And sometime, which is Weta and ILM, when the thing is, because I have by budget, I can do 5 time changes. Mm-hmm. So sometimes I arrived at the 5 and I'm very happy. And I said, great. Mm-hmm. Let us come back one next week. Maybe we have a, and sometime from them, they upgrade again. Mm. And I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe that. I said, how can you make it better? I said, we'll see. You see next week. So I was the first. I was very happy to be the first moviegoer to watch these shots coming every day. I mean, every week. It blew my mind. I mean, the work they have done is just amazing.
And is it different for you when you see it in other formats like IMAX? Do you have a different experience as a viewer?
Not so much IMAX. The 3D also, yeah. The team who did the 3D come with another layer of thing. And it's not the same experience. It's the film is even a little bit different with mm-hmm. the 3D. And I'm not a big fan of 3Ds, except Avatar, for example. Mm-hmm. But this one, honestly, if you have the opportunity, watch it in 3D because it's really impressive.
I've seen it in 3D, actually. Yeah. They showed it to us in 3D. Sitting backwards a lot, though, but I think we saw it in 3D the first time. Okay, so Kara and Dane, another topic of conversation that comes up with a lot of people.
Really?
Well, there's a sense of, they're both like movie stars on the cusp. They're not, you know, it's not Leo DiCaprio and whomever and Charlize Theron running around on screen. How much of that is, my feeling watching it was that it seemed to be like a decision on your part to find actors who were actors first and not necessarily that kind of celebrity. Is that reasonable or?
No, you resume the situation very well. When you have to cast someone, who do you take? The best person for the part? Or do you have another reason? I don't have another reason. My only reason is I want the best person to play the part. Mm-hmm. Now, you choose someone very popular, great, wonderful. You take someone not popular, all right, okay, we will have to work more. But you're never wrong when you take the best person for the part. Look at this summer. There's a bunch of film with superstar, 20 millions. They all flops. Mm-hmm. So no one knows. I mean, you know, you can't be wrong with getting the best actor for the part. You can't get wrong.
Is there something about those particular actors that connects with these characters?
Oh, I've seen many actors and actresses for the part, mm-hmm. and I just choose the two that I recognized, because I know Laura Lean and Valerian since 30 years, so I know them. I can recognize them if I come in a room. So I knew it was them for sure.
Was it a quick decision? Was it an easy?
It was very quick with Dane, because Dane has a background as an actor and he's very, and is an excellent actor. A little longer with Kara, because at the time she didn't do any movies. So mm-hmm. I didn't know. I knew that I'd love her for the part, but I have to verify that she can play the part. So I torture her a little bit for a couple of days, and then she succeeds. She succeeds all the tricks and all the tortures. She's still alive after that, and she's. It's a big discovery for the film, because some people were like skeptical and say, "Oh, she's not an actress. She's a model. She was not so good in Suicide Squad." But you know, I always said if a Ferrari doesn't go very fast, don't accuse the Ferrari. Accuse the driver. Mm-hmm. So she is a Ferrari. She just have to know how to drive it.
Of course, by the time Suicide Squad came out, you were very pregnant with her on this movie anyway. It wasn't like it was an issue.
When I watched the film and I saw her, I was not disappointed. I can see that there's some choices that or made by the director. I mean, the director is always the one. I remember this big thing on Marion Cotillard mm-hmm. on the death, you know, in Batman, where the entire internet just like flies on her to kill her. And I never understand that. Never. She, you know, like she probably did 25 takes, The director is a big guy. If he's not happy, he's going to shoot again. Mm-hmm. So if this take is in the film, it's because the director likes it. So it's not the responsibility of her. If they want to blame someone, they should blame the director, but not her. Mm-hmm. She's an actress. She made the death that he wants. And all the heat went on her.
Yeah.
And I never understand that. I've made 5 films with Mario. You know, she's a Lamborghini.
Yeah.
So she will deliver whatever you ask. But if you ask for something not so good, that's your fault, not mm-hmm. her.
So you are kind of the discoverer of Marianne on some level. I mean, Taxi really is what made her blow up initially. And that was a comedy, pretty much. Did you expect that she had the kind of range as an actor that we found out that she had?
Yeah, you can tell that she was a part. She was kind of exceptional. Mm. You can tell. Comedy was not exactly her thing, and then she grabbed it like this. She knows. You can tell. You didn't know that she could go until at this level and get an Oscar and all this, but you definitely you know she's on the top of the pack for sure.
You have a lot of talent around you that you've kind of developed over the years, particularly directors. Is that something you're proud of? Do you feel like you're you've created a number of the action directors that work in Hollywood now, had success, some of them in the movie as captains in the opening sequence. Is that something you're proud of, or do you feel like you have a hand in it, or you're just
no,
kind of there?
No, it's, you know what, I'm. They are talented since the beginning, and I see it. And if I have a quality, it's just maybe this one. I can see talent in the others. And when I start at 17, 18, there's not so many people who see me being talented. They don't see anything. I did some short film. They don't see anything. Mm-hmm. But some, few people say, this little short film, this one, this guy, he has something. And some of these people help me. So I just try to do the same, because I know that sometime producers, studios, they see a film and they don't even, I'm always amazed by the story of this film that the studio, one of the big studio made, and they watch the film and they say, you know, I'm sorry. They say to the director, we're going to go straight to video because, you know, the film is okay, but we don't know how to sell it, and da-da-da. And the directors fight and say, come on, you can't kill me. So they finally put the film in turnaround and went to another studio, and it's Slumdog Millionaire. And it's like 7 Oscars, $500 million box office. So, and then you're always like, how these people in the room cannot see. You know, you're a tennis trainer, mm-hmm. and then you see Boris Becker, or you know, the Spanish guy,
Nadal. Yeah.
And then you say, nah, we'll never go anywhere. it's our job. So if you can't see it, just take another job.
Well, it's funny because I've had that experience also with movies that were, you know, studios had not put in turnaround, but that they, some of the, like The Matrix. I always remember seeing The Matrix the first time, and the studio clearly did not know that it was The Matrix. They knew it was, they thought it was okay.
Really?
But they did not see it as this giant thing, and they gave it a, you know, fairly weak release date. It was an late April release date back then. It was nothing. April was not a good month. And they just kind of like threw it out there, and then when I saw the movie, I was like, this is, you could see them instantly, and almost everybody in the room could, that this is going to be one of the great movies of the number of years.
Yeah. It happens every month.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's got to be frustrating as a filmmaker to, you know, even something like The Fifth Element, which has now found its place, that when it came out, it, you know, didn't get the berth necessarily to take it where.
No, I think. You know, it's just important to remind the people that they have the real power. Mm. The Wall of Berlin went down by the people, not the politicians. So we have the power. Mm. In Europe, in France, we went to Versailles and we take the king and then we cut his head. So the people at the end of the day, even if we feel sometimes like we are manipulated by everyone, but we are not. So it's up to decide when sometime we feel that the films are not creative enough, or it's the sequel number 5 or 10 or 12, and we want the things to change. The audience can send a message by once in a while going less to see this film, and when films like Valerian take a risk, then just to make a signal and say, try more of this shit. So we have the, I mean, the people have the power, and then it's healthy.
Of course, your company has not been afraid of sequels. You've, how many taxis are there? I think there were 5 of them, or 4
Yeah,
of them?
But we never planned it. It's not, it's different.
So this thing now where the franchises are kind of, you know that you're going to be number 5 in a few years is not your favorite thing?
No, it's not my favorite thing, but it also depends. Like for example, you take on TV, you have characters, Starkey and Hutch. You can watch Starkey and Hutch for 10 years. They are cops, and every time it's a new adventure. It's a new crime. It's a new villain. That's what I love about Valerian and Laureline. It's they are cops. And the first one is an adventure, and they try to resolve a problem. I don't mind to see them again at all next year if the adventure is different.
Right.
What I don't like so much, it's there's some superhero, it's the same town, it's the same story, you just change the villain, and then it's the same thing again. And it looks like the same thing. And that's what, as a moviegoer, that's what bothered me.
I kind of think that's why Cameron is taking so long to do Avatar again. And is that he's waiting to figure out something different.
Yeah, and he's right. He wants to do it good. And he's not taking any pressure of anyone. And he's right. He's the king.
So can you imagine, I mean, I don't wish it upon, I'm not, I don't know if I wish it upon you or not, but can you see, is there such a thing as a scaled down Valerian and Laureline for Netflix or for TV? Is it possible to do this as a series on some scale?
I don't know, but it's really not in the plan at all.
Because I've seen like there was an animated series of the characters and
yeah,
wrote
a long time
comic books.
Ago they did one, but it was bad. It was really bad.
So you go back to the early days of the comic books, that's your sense of the best of it?
Yeah, but I think that the scale of the adventures deserve a big screen and 3D. So let's concentrate on that. And, you know, it's not so many films who deserve that.
Right.
There's many films that you see on screens that you can watch on TV now. So, but some films where it's worth it to watch, you know, on a big screen.
So how often do you get to a movie theater?
Recently, not so much because we're finishing Valerian, but usually once a week, you know. And I always go on the real theater with people, my kids, popcorns. Like, I love the normal stuff. I don't like the private thing. And no, I like the real. I like to see all the trailers and have the guy next to me. No way. Not going to see this piece of shit. I love to hear all the comments.
And do you go see every kind of film, or is there
films?
Yeah,
every kind, yeah. Yeah, honestly.
So how is cinema these days, do you think? Everybody's kind of talking about the death spiral, but it seems like there's also a lot of life going on.
No, there's life. There's you're just obliged to filter a little more, you know? Okay, thank you, not this one. Oh, thank you, not this one. Oh, yeah, this one. Okay, good. You just have, you know, yeah, there is more product in the shell. So you need a little more time to figure out which one is really good and, you know.
So how often are you right when you go to the movies? Do you get surprised in a positive way very often, or?
Yeah, sometime.
And a lot of disappointment?
Not a lot, but it's interesting with the American cinema, because I'm open to every kind of cinema, and the American cinema is never bad. You know, even like a so-so comedy, it's not so bad. You always have a moment where you're smiling, and so that's the force, that's the strength of American cinema. So even if it's not very good, it's still good. When in Europe, for example, when it's not good, it's really bad. And sometimes the film start and you say, oh, okay, all right, okay. Kind of like, and then the characters, how it's written, the jokes, the situation, and at the end you're happy. You say, ah, that was good. It's a real strength, you know?
So are you do you see yourself in the fraternity of French filmmakers, or is it world filmmakers?
No, that's what I love about art, is no one is asking you for your passport. You know, Van Gogh was from Holland. The iris, who inspired him, was in France, and the painting is at the Metropolitan in New York. So, you know, it's totally. So, is it an American painting, a French painting, and a Holland painting? It's gorgeous. That's all. You know, you watch it and you say, "Oh my God, it's wonderful," and that's all it counts. So. That's what I love about art, is that at least it's the only country without frontiers and visa and passport and language, and it's great.
There does seem to be a certain arrogance about French directors, no? Like kind of like a...
Are you including me in it?
No. I mean, because you don't seem to be that kind of guy. But there seems to be kind of a, you know, a puffed out chest about the French cinema and the...
I don't know. Honestly, I don't know. I mean, the more I work... The more I work with humility, because every time you open a door and you think you know, there's 10 doors. So just like stay modest, do the best you can, and stay modest and be honest.
So what point will you get your greatest moment of satisfaction from the experience of Valerian? Is it something that already happened on the production?
Virginie, my producer, she was also my wife, the first time that we verified the print and we were just the two of us, and then we watched the entire film, just the two together. And then you have a, you know, you have a real moment of satisfaction of, all right, we made it, it's finished, it's pretty well made, and we're on time, on budget. Yeah, there we are. That for now, that was the best moment of satisfaction.
And will you carry it? Do you carry your films with you much after that? You know, in the next couple of years, will you think about Valerian a lot, or I'm sure you're already writing other things.
Oh, for me, it's finished already. Because the satisfaction I talk about is like 3 months ago. So, for me, it's. The film doesn't belong to me anymore. The film belongs to people, and I don't know what they're going to do with it. I hope they're going to take care of it, but I have to move on. I have to go to something else. So.
Is that a good feeling or a weird
feeling?
No,
it's a little sad. It's a little sad, but I'm used to it now. You have to do like this and not, okay, go now, go.
And does your real life, is there a line between your real life and your artistic life? Or is it?
Oh, that's probably the biggest problem in my life, is I spend more time on the other world.
Because you have a bunch of kids.
Yeah, but I'm writing every morning, and I'm, I don't know how you say it in English, dans la lune. I'm a little in the moon all the time. Space.
And are any of your kids old enough to have gone off on their own at this point?
Sorry?
Are any of your kids old enough to have gone off in their, over, you know, college or?
Yeah, two already.
So is that like sending off a movie? Off into the world?
Yeah, kind of. It's like a 18 years old kid who leave the house. Still your baby, but he has a girlfriend, and they're going to take an apartment, and, you know, you're... I love you, bye. it's the feeling, yeah.
So each day you get some creative experience.
Oh yeah.
You need that rush every day.
If I'm not visiting this other world in the day, I'm very nervous and cranky.
And does it generally keep you from being nervous and cranky, continuing to work?
If I work on the morning, if I'm writing, I wake up very early, around 4:30 or 5, and if I write for 2 hours, I'm a sweetheart for the rest of the day. Mm.
And do you always love the material, or do you finish your 2 hours saying?
Yeah, it doesn't matter. It's really like your gymnastic. If you do your gymnastic every day, that we all should do. I don't all the time, but I try. But you feel just better. Physically, you feel better, that's all.
And is there a moment where you know, okay, this thing that I'm writing at 4:30 to 6:30 every morning is beginning to be something that will end up really being a film?
Oh, yeah. You feel sometimes. You feel like you say, yeah, that's cool, that's funny.
The 40 pages in or 60 pages in or?
Of what?
Into the writing of something. How far along is something before you kind of going, oh, this is really?
No, sometimes it's just like pieces. Like there's a scene and you don't know if it will end up in the film, but maybe this scene will end up in the script in 10 years from now. Hmm. Like The Big Market in Valerian, I got the idea 12 years ago.
And it was impossible to make 12 years ago, I imagine.
I just have the idea.
Yeah.
I don't know what to do with it.
Are you amazed at any, in terms of Valerian, is there any other thing in the movie where you're just kind of stunned that it exists, given the limitations of film?
I think that because it's 7 years and I can't remember the beginning, sometimes I'm wondering how we did it. Mm. I don't know how we did it, because I don't remember the beginning, in fact.
And does it feel now like there's anything you can't do, given CG universe and?
Oh, in terms of CG, no, you can. The limit is the imagination. Mm.
And your imagination seems as big now as it was when
has
you were.
No limit, so.
Does it feel the same? Does you have the same rush when you were 10 and 12 and excited about all
I
this stuff?
I think it's even better. It's even better because I can play with it now. Before it was just an explosion. It was just that you cannot control. You don't know exactly what it means, but you're burning inside and you're exploding and then you're crying and then you're laughing. But now, with the time, you. For example, do we love better when we're a little older? I think so. It doesn't mean that when we were young, we were not honest about loving, but it's so, you know, we love like this when we're young. Mm-hmm. And with the experience, with the time, you know the value of things, and then I think the quality of the love is better. So I think it's the same for the imagination and the films. You know better the value of everything. Mm.
You seem like a very peaceful, satisfied, but full, emotionally satisfied person at this point. Is that fair? Do you feel that way? Do you feel that you are that person, or?
Yeah, I feel good.
Well, it just seems like you're doing the things you want to do. You have control of your craft. You have. You know, an audience that
I'm doing what I like, but I don't force anyone. If sometimes things doesn't go well and I have to not to do the thing, I'm fine. But I, you know, when I was younger, sometimes people try to impose me like a casting or something that I don't feel, and I went to the Clash a few times, and when I said okay, that's fine, I don't do it. It doesn't matter. I mean, some people would rather make a concession because they say, when I did my film, I can do another one. I'm not like this. I don't know how to do it. Mm. So if you don't like it, I'm fine. It's okay. But I won't do it. That's it. That's all. That's my freedom. Mm. So where it's difficult sometimes is I'm always amazed because when you make a film or a painting, it's a sweet proposal. You propose to the people to spend 2 hours to watch a story, and they're not even obliged to come. They can say no, thank you, and it's fine. So I'm sometimes disturbed to see that this kind gesture creates so much hate. Mm. People are like, sometimes they're so mean and they aggress you, they insult you, and you say, hey, just don't go, it's fine, you're not obliged to, nothing is wrong. Mm. And you see every day on the newspaper, politicians, big guys, people selling weapons, you know, like all these guys, and everybody's like, shh. And we don't say anything about these guys. Mm. But why the one who have no guns,
right,
are the one that we try to kill? You know, this is something I didn't resolve yet in my life.
Well, it's a fascinating thing. I always say that journalists have the thinnest skin, even though a lot of critics, at least, have the, you know, are kind of constantly in the position of judging. And I know for me that it sometimes, particularly for things when there are things I don't like, it's exhausting. I find it emotionally draining to not like something in many cases.
But I think that something went wrong at a certain point, because we always try to put in opposition the creative person and the journalist. And it's almost two camp. You know, like, mm-hmm. We are making things, you judge the thing. And for me, since the beginning, I would love to feel that the person is in the same camp. For me, the journalist is someone who loves art and wants to help art. So that what I'm waiting for is like, oh my God, you should see this little film or this big film, it doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. I love, you will see the guy, how he played the part, it's amazing. Then they're gonna bring few people, to discover that. Mm-hmm. And that's for me the role. The role is, you know, is helping that. And when sometime you don't like something, why to make 3 pages about it? To say, oh, it's a piece of shit, it's this, it's that. Why? What's the point? You're not creating anything. You're going to stop people to go to the movie theater because they're going to say, oh, I want to go, but I read the thing and I'm not going to go. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we are creating an anti-movement, and that's wrong. It's better to use the energy, and it's not a way of saying, like, I want all the artists to be flattered. It's for me, the role, mm-hmm. should be the one, this one. It should be like a translator. And I want them to be in my team, not, mm-hmm. not on the other team. And if someone doesn't like my film, then he doesn't talk about it.
Right.
And then he put 2 pages on the other one that he loves. And mm-hmm. that's good. And people are not stupid, you know, if they see that. They follow you on the newspaper and they see that you're talking about this one, but you're not talking about the others, yeah. And they know what you think.
Though people get attention for being negative. I think that's in some ways the thing.
Like I have on Valerian, there's many, many, and thanks to them, there's many like amazing critics on papers. Everybody is talking about one who like, you know, insult me and then try to kill me. Mm-hmm. Everybody's talking about this one. That's their choice, you know?
Yeah. Well, it's like Anthony Lane put a book out, and it's mostly his negative reviews. And you're like, if you love film, why are you putting out a book of negative reviews? It's like, that's not...
There's this famous book from the 70s. It's a tiny book. I have it somewhere, and I love it, because it's a journalist who took all the reviews at the time. Mm-hmm. So you have, for example, this critic who say... Oh, it's just, you know, à la mode. In 1 month, we won't talk about them anymore, the Beatles. Mm-hmm. She doesn't know how to sing, Maria Callas. And we have this thing that between directors that it's a book that we offer to each other. It's so funny. It's so funny.
Yeah, it's unfortunate. But you seem to have risen above.
Yeah.
I guess you have no choice.
The film is over anyway, so it won't change the film.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, I'm glad we have the film, and I'm glad we have you. Thank you very much for your time.
Really welcome.
I appreciate it.
Thank you.